Food. It is vital to human survival. It permeates our culture, customs, and conventions. But where does it come from? How is our food grown? Well, if you're like most Americans, your food comes from a place like this, or this, or even this. But food production wasn't always like this. If we rewind the clock 100 years, we will see a big difference in our world of agriculture. Back then, farming was simple. Farmers would grow food to feed themselves and their families and would make a living selling their produce to local markets. Although the size of the trade differed throughout the world, these subsistence methods were generally the same. There were no synthetic fertilizers, no pesticides, and the seeds were harvested from each year's previous crops. However, this led to significant global challenges. Less developed countries that lacked established infrastructures and had unfavorable climates were often exposed to droughts, floods, fungus, and disease. If there was an extended dry season or a locust infestation, entire communities would suffer. Economies would collapse, abject poverty would strike, vulnerable populations were decimated. In short, global inequality correlated to food insecurity. This cycle, where some countries had ample food while other countries suffered through drought and famine, would last for several generations. Until one day, one man decided he would end this cycle.
More than half the farmers of the world live in a subsistence agriculture outside of the economies of their own country.
As one war raged against fascism and tyranny, biologist Dr. Norman Borlaug decided to fire a few bullets of his own. Not against Hitler, not against Mussolini, but instead, he declared war on hunger. He was tired of encountering the millions of lives lost to global starvation. As a biologist, he explored a scientific solution. He explored ways to genetically modify crops in order to make plants resilient to bad weather, resistant to disease, and abundantly fertile. The concept of genetically modified plants was not a new concept to biologists. In fact, most of the scientific community had some knowledge about the potential of GMOs, but Borlaug, in his relentless exploration to end world hunger, was the first to act on it. He and his team began their work in Mexico in 1944.
People that I brought to Mexico, I always told them on the first day, we're going to teach you to be rebels, not with guns and daggers, but with science and technology.
Through the partnership with the Rockefeller Foundation and Mexican agro-scientists, Borlaug explored the possibility of scientifically increasing Mexico's national wheat yields.
All of these people who are part of our staff here at the present time are the people who have made most of the contributions.
Borlaug employed tactics such as introducing synthetic fertilizers, pesticides, even crossbreeding 6,000 different wheat strains to isolate and repeat favorable traits. During his work, Borlaug made unprecedented agricultural breakthroughs. The most significant was the dwarfing of wheat through speciation, which created a stronger stalk. During the 1950s and 60s, Mexico embraced the scientific and technological methods promoted by Norman Borlaug. The outcome of his efforts? Mexico's national wheat yields tripled. By 1963, Mexico's wheat supply was so abundant that Mexico actually became an exporter of wheat. Norman Borlaug had succeeded. He was making a difference. But Borlaug wasn't finished exchanging his ideas. He took his innovations to South Asia. He exchanged his ideas with Pakistan and India. Using the same techniques that he leveraged in Mexico, he nearly doubled his wheat yields in these countries. This greatly improved their food security as well as their living conditions. Soon, many countries began exchanging strains and sharing knowledge on Borlaug's genetic crossing techniques. Each new country that employed his ideas also increased their wheat yields. Norman Borlaug had saved millions of lives from the hell of starvation. Because of his unyielding scientific exploration and global exchange, and after encountering many obstacles in the way of his progress, crops all over the world were now immune to disease and fungus, resilient to drought, and inoculated from infestations. They were protected. They were plentiful. For the first time in history, man had control over nature. Norman Borlaug had launched the Green Revolution. He is considered to be the man who saved 1 billion lives. He won the Nobel Peace Prize for his work in agriculture in 1970. Today, almost every country uses his tactics that stem from his research and explorations on genetic modification and speciation. Norman Borlaug was the hero of the 20th century. Or was he? There were unintended consequences that stemmed from these scientific breakthroughs, unforeseen by Borlaug and those he exchanged his ideas with. The family farm virtually disappeared and was replaced by large corporate-owned production facilities. They were no longer farms, they were factories run by technology, focusing on producing as much commercial crops as possible, as fast as possible. As the need for land increased, more of the natural environment had to be destroyed, deforesting rainforests, displacing natural habitats, and endangering species on a scale never before seen. The chemicals applied to help plants grow, including fertilizers and pesticides, often got caught in runoff after a rain and poisoned watersheds that local populations relied upon for potable water. The original pesticides Borlaug used, such as DDT, were later linked to cancer. Food modification guaranteed abundance and success, but it was without regard for environmental sustainability. And regardless of these consequences, we used more land, more pesticides, more food, more profit, more. If deforestation continues at its current rate, in 200 years there won't be an acre of rainforest left on the planet. Our world will be one big desert. If we keep draining our aquifers for irrigation, they will be completely dried up in a matter of decades, which will eventually lead to water wars and a potential global famine. I don't think this is what Norman Borlaug had in mind. Borlaug explored ways to alleviate the hunger pandemic he encountered. He wanted everyone in the entire world, regardless of status, income, or race, to have access to food. Then why, when according to the United Nations Food Program, our global farm output can feed an estimated 12 billion, 3 billion still go hungry? Shouldn't everyone have a garden? Shouldn't every person on Earth have access to clean water? Is it not every person's right to have access to fertile seeds? We know the Green Revolution and Norman Borlaug's exchange of ideas was beneficial, but questions still remain. Is there a better way? Can we build on his work to create solutions to avoid what might be a bleak future? We, as a human race, must ask ourselves, what would Norman do?
Must be some kind of way out of here. Say the joker to the thief.